It's been a busy day and a busy week, like it always is here in the city of Houston. And with me today, we've got members of the Houston Police Department, a robbery team that does a phenomenal job. We've got our ATF partners. We have Pasadena PD. Who else do we have? Who am I missing? Montgomery County DAs. Come on up. Well, don't be shy. Take off that sticker, though. It looks kind of tacky. No stickers. Who else? Where's my DA from Harris County? Come on up. Okay. Can you go on? One of you, let's go on this side. We got to balance the shot here. It's already too wide with me. But today we're going to talk about, you know, we know that the biggest public safety threat in this city truly is from the criminal element. We have a city and a police department that has 300 fewer officers in 2018 than we had 20 years ago, despite the fact that we've grown as a city by 500 million people. At the same time, we've reduced our civilian staffing, our support staffing, by about 43%. At the same time, we've reduced our overtime budget by millions of dollars, actually, probably close to double digit. And so when you have a police department that is serving in an area with 640 square miles with 20,000 known gang members, 18,000 parolees, it makes excellence in policing that much more important. It makes being data-driven, intelligence-led, and most importantly, having phenomenal people like Detective Neely back here. And most importantly, it requires teamwork. And so today what we're going to talk about is one crew of robbers that are responsible for a multitude, over 30 aggravated robberies with involving deadly weapons. They're responsible for aggravated sexual assaults, and they're responsible for terrorizing this city. And I'm happy to say that because of the work of the Houston Police Department and the partnership with our colleagues across this region, they're going to be going hopefully to prison for the rest of their lives, as far as I'm concerned. Not only will they be facing state charges here in Texas, but we're quite confident that the U.S. Attorney's Office will be pursuing other charges. It'll be federal charges, and so hopefully there'll be a ping pong ball going in and out, going from one prison to another, but not back into the community to terrorize. So the suspects that we have in custody include Charles Craig, also known as LaCharles Crage, I guess you can say it, Trenton Jackson, Cameron Lucas, and Marquise Clark. They are linked to an excess of 30 aggravated robberies with deadly weapons and two aggravated sexual assault cases in Houston and our surrounding areas. In the majority of these cases, they created fear in the customers, terrorized them, the customers and employees, by pointing handguns and semi-automatic weapons in a threatening manner and demanding cash from the registers, the complainant's personal property, and threatened to inflict serious bodily injury. Their crime spree lasted for several weeks, and investigators from several agencies, including the fact that they robbed, are good for at least two robberies in Missouri City. They're good for two robberies in Pasadena. They're good for one robbery in the Montgomery County Sheriff's Department jurisdiction, and one robbery in the Sugar Land Police Department jurisdiction. This is why we always talk about, in this region, none of us live on an island, and the crooks that impact Houston today will impact someone tomorrow, and why we're working so diligently to actually work together collaboratively in our region. The beginning of the end of this crime spree started on August 23rd, 2018, when the suspects robbed, committed an aggravated robbery using deadly weapons and sexual assault at 15803 East Tex Freeway in the middle of the night, around 3 in the morning, and during that robbery sexually assaulted a young female inside that location. That night, fortunately for the victims of these suspects, and fortunately for the victims that will not become victims, that young woman that was sexually assaulted was able to hit the panic alarm at that location, exact bookstore. Patrol officers from our North Belt Division responded, like they do when they know that there's people in harm. When there's gunfire, police officers run towards it, not away from it. Our officers knew that there was a panic alarm and a business struck. They responded, And to make a long story short, they end up engaging the suspects, going in pursuit of the suspects. They went in a pursuit that's over 3 miles long at a high rate of speed. The suspects crashed out. And fortunately, thanks to the efforts of our North Belt officers, Officer Carlisle, he's a patrol officer, and Officer Rodriguez, who's his partner, did a phenomenal job of responding, pursuing, and ultimately capturing one of the suspects that night. As a result of the capture of that suspect by our patrol officers, we were able to call up Detective Neely and his partner, who's right behind me. They responded to the scene, and through some great police work, they were able to not just charge that suspect, but as I said earlier, they were able to identify and charge three other suspects with not just a series of aggravated robberies with deadly weapons, but also sexual assaults. Let me just highlight a couple of things, then we'll open up the questions, and Detective Neely, and we'll open up to a couple other people, then we'll come back for his questions. But every time someone gets hurt in a pursuit in this city, an innocent person, people try to point the fingers at the police. Why are we chasing? And let me just tell you this. I am strongly of the belief that a blanket policy to not pursue violent criminals is an invitation to chaos. If we were in a city that does not allow officers to pursue violent criminals, and those cities do exist, and I would tell you to go find those cities and see what's going on in those cities, as it isn't good, we wouldn't be standing here today talking about solving 30 aggravated robberies with deadly weapons and sexual assault. We have to conduct pursuits, and at the end of the day, when those pursuits go sideways, there's only one individual to blame, as far as I'm concerned, in most instances, and that's that suspect that, despite the well-known knowledge that pursuits are dangerous for everyone involved, showed no regard for the safety of anyone and engaged in that reckless behavior in the first place. Now, having said that, we will continue to utilize Star Chase, which is the DART system that we've deployed throughout our city, to try to manage pursuits and try to avoid having to engage them when possible. We are continuing to train our officers in the pursuit intervention technique. That's a great tool that's already being used to bring these pursuits to an end. And when appropriate, we will discontinue a pursuit when the crime that we are chasing the suspect for doesn't really justify the risk. And even when the crime is an egregious crime, there are times when we will call it off, because that's just the prudent thing to do at that time. So I want to just say to everyone here, before I turn it over to the ATF for some brief comments, that once again, this is proof positive that the number one threat to this city continues to be violent criminals. And anything that we do to hamper the ability of the Houston Police Department, that is absolutely understaffed, right, is, I think, unconscionable. And so when we talk about a lot of things that are going on in our city, I just left City Hall, I would just ask the people of the city, pay attention. Pay attention to the crime that this police department is fighting with our partners. Pay attention to the challenges, and pay attention to the cost of the things and the debates that are going on as it relates to public safety. Because what keeps me up at night is still these people. When I get to sleep at night, those patrol officers, Carlisle and Rodriguez, get to go chase armed suspects, armed sexual assault suspects, armed robbers, right? And we need more Carlisles and more Rodriguez's and more detectives like Detective Neely and his partner, not fewer. And so, word to the wise, despite our greatest efforts, we still have a great challenge here in this city, and we need to stay focused on the greatest threat, and that still remains violent crime and violent criminals. So with that, I'll do a little Spanish, because they're starting to stare at me, right? Anybody want to do Spanish for me? Really? You sure? Yes, I've heard your Spanish. That's worse than mine. Bueno, esta mañana estamos muy orgullosos, estamos aquí para hablar sobre un caso donde el Departamento de Policía de Houston, investigadores de nuestro departamento, han arrestado y tenemos cargas contra cuatro sospechosos que cometieron una serie de asaltos armados y asaltos sexuales, robos armados. El día 23 de agosto, a las 3 de la mañana, fueron a un local que estaba abierto las 24 horas, asaltaron y robaron, y también esa noche cometieron asaltos sexuales. Estoy muy orgulloso de los oficiales Carlisle y Rodríguez, que son oficiales de patrulleros, que gracias a Dios, la muchacha que fue violada sexualmente con estos sospechosos que ven aquí, pudo aprender el botón de emergencia y nuestros oficiales llegaron. Hubo una persecución en los vehículos y gracias a Dios los oficiales de la patrulla esa noche encontraron y arrestaron uno de los sospechosos. Esa noche llamamos al detective Neely y a sus colegas de la unidad que investiga estas clases de casos, y eso fue en pensar del final de cuatro sospechosos que ven que cometieron por lo menos 30 asaltos y dos asaltos sexuales, robos armados y dos asaltos sexuales. Esto para mí es evidencia de la excelencia de nuestros colegas, también la colaboración que tenemos con nuestros amigos a nivel federal del ATF, nuestros amigos en otros departamentos, pues estos sospechosos asaltaron, cometieron 20 robos que sabemos aquí en la ciudad de Houston, y también cometieron robos dos en Missouri City, dos en Pasadena, dos en el condado de Montgomery y uno en Sugar Land. Pero esto es evidencia que el peligro más grande que existe en la seguridad pública en esta ciudad sigue el peligro del crimen violento. Y cuando tenemos un departamento policiaco que tiene 300 menos policías hoy que hace 20 años atrás, pues medio millón más habitantes, tenemos que tener estas agentes que para mí son héroes. Así que con eso vamos a, en un momento después que hable el ATF, vamos a abrirlo a las preguntas. Is that enough? Very good. Okay, with that, ATF, can you make some comments about what we've been doing in our partnership here? Oh, there he is. He's like a ninja, right? He's really...
Thank you. ATF is very happy to be partnered with the Houston Police Department, as well as all of our other state and local partners. ATF's primary mission is reducing violent crime, and that's exactly why we're here assisting and partnering on this particular investigation. ATF will always bring forth any resources that we have available. One that we'll probably use here is NIBIN, the National Integrated Ballistic Information System. We'll look at linking any other further aggravated robberies or shootings that these guys may be involved with. That's what we have right now. Thank you.
Okay. We'll open up the questions. Anybody else want to say anything? And then we'll open up the questions.
We've covered some of these, I recognize from the video, and they just, I mean, people were talking about them because they were so violent. Can you just rehash a little bit, just give viewers, people out there, the idea how violent these robberies were?
Well, I think, first of all, I mean, sexual assaults are something that's being talked about because of the political landscape right now. And we've got two sexual assault victims here, right? That to me, that is something that impacts the victim for life, right? It's a lifelong impact that kind of violence has on someone. No one should be subjected to sexual assault under any circumstances, but think about it. At a business trying to make a living, and a group of thugs come in and then sexually assault you. They're cowards. It was extremely violent. It was extremely scary. It was extremely terrorizing. And it was the Houston Police Department patrol officers that in the middle of the night responded, engaged them, pursued them, captured one. And that's the excellence of this man, Detective Neely and his team, that was able to start connecting the dots, that cleared the cases for everyone. And then obviously our partners with the ATF and Montgomery County and Harris County and the U.S. attorneys, that now what we're going to do is we want to put them behind bars and leave them behind bars. People like this, I mean, there's been a debate about three strikes in this country. I think when you go into a location and you brutally attack people and you sexually assault a woman, I believe in one strike. I don't think I need to see them around my neighborhood. And so I'm hopeful now that because of their excellence that they'll be where they need to be. This is just four people, 30 robberies, two sexual assaults. So with that, Ken, why don't you talk a little bit about the actual crimes and how they carried them out.
Thank you, Chief. It's kind of, and good morning, everyone. It's kind of like the Chief said, these guys, they definitely displayed a propensity for violence. Like I say, we had them listed and linked to over 30 robberies in different counties in the city. In each crime, it seemed they became more brazen. The actions they were displaying was putting grief and fear. I've talked to several of the complainants subsequently during the investigation. Some of them were getting counseling. Some of them having problems sleeping at night. Some of them are afraid to go back to work. Because you would think that, you know, aside from being at home, you would be safe at your place of employment. These four suspects prevented that from several people. And some people may never be able to recover from this. So it was really a great collective effort between so many agencies that work exceptionally well together. HPD robbery just can't take the credit from this. We had a great assistance from the ATF, Pasadena, Montgomery County, Fort Bend, Sugar Land. It was definitely a collective effort because just by all the agencies that I indicated, that lets you know exactly how far along these guys are going. So we're stretching from Montgomery County all the way down to Fort Bend, Sugar Land, and Pasadena, and we're still looking at other agencies where we think they may be linked to it. So for us, this is a very good moment for the Houston Police Department as well as our partners, and we feel very confident that during the prosecution of these suspects, as the Chief said, that they will probably never be able to walk free again.
Can you tell us which ones were the sex assaults? I know, was it that last one on August 23rd?
That is correct, yes, ma'am.
That one.
Yes,
do you know
ma'am.
The other date, the other sex assault?
11th.
August the 11th.
On the 11th, okay, so this. There were two on the 11th. Was it the Broadway Street?
Was it
Broadway or
93rd?
On 93rd Street.
93rd Street, okay. And was it the same person charged with both sexual assaults?
Well,
two different suspects?
Actually, we have two different suspects for each case.
Okay.
We have one charge. And another has been identified, and we're just waiting on some analysis from the lab to come back to confirm that.
Can you tell us who was charged in the one on August 23rd with sexual assault? It just says in the press release that Craig.
Yes, ma'am. He is charged for that one on
August
23rd. Yes, ma'am.
Thank you. And we don't know. Then the other one is not definitive.
No, we're still waiting on some analysis from lab work to come back from the process of DNA.
Anything else, guys?
I was just going to say, if these guys weren't, I mean, would they have just continued to do this, do you think? Is that the kind of serial, you know, I mean, no one died, but these were pretty violent. Do you think that would have happened if these guys were not arrested?
I believe so. Like I say, it increased by the cases, and we have some video that we've looked at. There have been some rounds fired in some of the cases that we worked by the suspects. So invariably, we believe it would have happened. So we're just very thankful that we were able to arrest them on the 23rd and the next few days to get the other three suspects in custody.
Have you been able to talk with some of their victims? I'm sure there's relief there.
Yes, ma'am. That's a lot of relief. Like I said, a lot of the victims that we've spoken to, myself, Detective Curtis, and some of the other detectives involved in the other agencies, we've talked to them. And just to let them know, to kind of reassure them that these guys are no longer menaces to them or anyone else in society. So a lot of them did seek comfort from that, being told that. But there are others who, again, that are definitely still seeking treatment and counseling just for this is a very terrifying situation that they were placed in.
Any idea why the crime spree spread out over such a large area? Could it possibly be to throw police off in that open direction?
No, sir. I really think it was just the fact that they were mobile. They had vehicles. You know, with the highway and byway systems that we have, all the connecting roads and highways, that was just an opportunity for them to just go out.
Okay, anything else, guys?
Las víctimas de estos casos, ¿cómo están
ahora que saben que por lo menos ya fueron capturados.
Bueno, las víctimas, todas las víctimas tenían mucho temor que estos sospechosos estaban libres en la comunidad y están bien tienen bien, gran alivio sabiendo que nuestros oficiales, nuestros investigadores han capturado todos estos sospechosos y que van a ir a la prisión con el favor de Dios por el resto de su vida. Así que para mí es importante que nosotros siempre decimos a la comunidad que la justicia tenemos que buscarla juntos. Tenemos que ganarnos la confianza, tenemos que trabajar juntos. No podemos permitir que dejen o permita a cualquier persona que comete un crimen violento y que no lo traemos a la justicia. Porque el que es víctima hoy o testigo hoy, mañana otro familiar es víctima o es testigo. Así que están bien aliviados.
Arrestado gracias a una persecución de dos oficiales,
sí,
que dio con el arresto de
claro,
los tres. Y entonces, ¿qué le dice usted al público que dicen cuando ven una persecución, por qué lo persiguen?
Mire, me sirve una cosa para mí que cuando, si nosotros en los departamentos policíacos no le caemos atrás, no hay persecución, cayéndole atrás a los criminales violentos, ¿qué quieren que haga? Si no fuera por esa persecución, esa noche, si no fuera porque nuestros oficiales tienen el coraje para caerle atrás a estos sospechosos violentos, no estuviéramos aquí como una comunidad de enforzamiento dándole la gran noticia a esta comunidad que cuatro sospechosos responsables por lo menos 30 asaltos agravados con arma de fuego, por lo menos dos actos de asaltos sexuales con arma de fuego, todavía estuvieran en la calle y tuviéramos más víctimas. Así que, gracias a Dios, ninguna vida fue perdida, pero nosotros tenemos que caerle atrás a los criminales, porque si no, no va a haber paz, no va a haber seguridad, y eso va a ser una gran desgracia para nuestra comunidad. Okay, all right, everybody, thank you very much. Have a good day.